Go ahead and open up your Bibles to the book of Mark. We're in chapter 2, and we're going to be continuing our teaching series, sermon series from Mark chapter 2. Before we do, let me go ahead and have a prayer. Father, we thank you so much for your word, and we thank you that how powerful and mysterious and beyond comprehension you are, you still have revealed yourself to us. You've revealed your will, you've revealed your heart, you've revealed your love, and you revealed yourself in the clearest way that people could understand, and that is by becoming a person yourself, in your Son, Jesus Christ. We thank you so much for his life, for his love, and as we continue this series through the book of Mark, my prayer is that Jesus would really, really come alive. Really come alive, not just in the stories of the scriptures, but in our hearts and in our everyday lives. And we can still hear his words speaking to us. That his lessons can penetrate our hearts and just continue to change our lives today here and now. We love you and thank you. And it's in his name, amen. Well, last week we began a stretch of narrative in Mark chapter 2, where we saw Jesus and the religious establishment of his day begin to clash. And this tension began to grow. When Jesus came, he announced the imminent arrival of the kingdom of God. Now, of course, this created a clash because the entrenched religious establishment of the day already believed and assumed that, well, the kingdom was already present. And it was present in them and through the things that they represented. Despite the many good intentions of the religious teachers and the leaders, this group that we talked about, the Pharisees, experts of the law, they had a zealous commitment to holiness, but the religious culture that they created had become humanistic. It had become legalistic. And in too many ways, it actually created distance and separation between the people and the kingdom of God than it did to bring them closer to it. And when Jesus came, he came to correct that course and to really open the door to the kingdom. Last week, for those of us who are here, you may remember, we left off in the narrative where Jesus talked about needing to be new wineskins, pouring new wine into new wineskins, and that the teachings of the kingdom required a new outlook, a new perspective, a new heart. That the perspective and the thinking of the Old Testament or the Old Covenant or Moses' law, it could not contain the teachings of the kingdom. He was telling the religious folks of his day that they still needed to change. They needed to change if they really wanted to grasp the teachings of the kingdom of God. And this feeds into the call to repentance. Repentance, which is a shift in mind and a shift in heart, a shift in perspective. Repentance is not just for the ungodly sinner. Repentance was also for the zealously religious. The ongoing need for the religiously devoted to grow, to evolve, to change. Again, I think the overarching lesson for us is let's let Jesus continue to confront the religious establishment of our own hearts. If we're spiritual people, if we're religious and we have a faith and we continue in that for some time, we too can become entrenched in a religious establishment. Maybe it's not an outward one, but it can be an inward one. Certain assumptions or attitudes or points of view that we just grow into that actually need to continue to change. They need to continue to evolve. We need to continue to let Jesus challenge and confront the religiosity of our own hearts. As we'll see in the narrative today, there's two spiritual conditions that can arise that threaten the growth of the kingdom of God as much as any obvious sin. These spiritual conditions arise out of religious establishment and religious entrenchment, and their legalism and the hardened heart. Let's go ahead and read chapter 2. We'll pick up in verse, it's not verse 13. It's actually going to be verse 23. The text is right. The reference is wrong. So, amen. Jesus was going through the grain fields on the Sabbath, and his disciples began to pick some heads of wheat as they made their way. So the Pharisees said to him, "Look, why are they doing what is against the law on the Sabbath?" And he said to them, "Have you never read what David did when he was in need, and he and his companions were hungry? How he entered the house of God when Abiathar was high priest and ate the sacred bread, which is against the law for any but the priest to eat, and also David and his companions?" Then he said to them, "The Sabbath is made for people, not people for the Sabbath. For this reason, the Son of Man is Lord, even of the Sabbath." The dangers of legalism. Perhaps the most venerated and sacred law of the Jews was the law of the Sabbath. The Sabbath, honoring the Sabbath, was not only listed amongst the Ten Commandments, but the Sabbath had its origins back to creation itself. If we recall the creation narrative, it said the Lord rested on the final day. So from the perspective of the Jews, the Sabbath was the original, most sacred, most highly venerated law to honor. And in an effort to obey it as meticulously as possible, there was this effort amongst the religious leaders and the religious teachers to define what work was. Because if the expectation was to rest from your work, and we wanted to make sure that we really honored the Sabbath, and so let's define what work is. The leaders came up with actually 39 categories of work. And each category then also had subcategories that was also defined, and these stipulations were meticulous. You were prohibited from even touching tools associated with work. Because the thinking was that if you touched a tool associated with work, you might then accidentally manipulate that tool in a way that could resemble work, and then you'd be in violation of the Sabbath. So to be safe, you're not even allowed to touch tools associated with work. And to be even extra safe, workers who use tools were actually told to stop their work a half an hour before the Sabbath began. So that way they wouldn't lose track of time and then perhaps continue their work into the Sabbath. It included things like defining the difference between wearing something and carrying something. Because if you carried something, if you carried a burden, that could be considered work. So if I had an article and I was carrying it in my hand, that could be considered work. Which is why in another place in the gospel, a man that was healed by Jesus, and he rolled up his mat and he carried it, because now he could walk on the Sabbath. And he was accused of violating the Sabbath for carrying his mat. But if somehow I could wear the article, then it was okay. Because I was wearing something as opposed to carrying it. There were limitations on the number of steps that you could take away from your domicile. Because you were to rest at home. And so if you walked too far away from home, you'd be in violation. And then there was another set of codes defining the area around where you lived, what was considered your domicile and what wasn't. You get the idea here, right? The minutiae of these definitions became so meticulous. See, the Pharisees were strategic in the way they came after Jesus. They waited for the Sabbath to begin to accuse Jesus of things. Because rules were so complicated that it was easy to find something, some way that someone was tripping up on the Sabbath, if you didn't know and understand all the permutations of these definitions. And if a supposed holy man like Jesus were to violate the Sabbath, well, it would, one, expose that he's not very holy because the Sabbath is so important. And two, it would also expose he couldn't be holy because he doesn't understand all the laws and rules and regulations for the Sabbath. And so here we have Jesus and his guys just walking, strolling along by a field, through a field, and you know what? They got a little bit And in getting a little bit hungry as they're walking by the edge of the field, they reach out and just grab a few heads of grain to just crunch and snack on. Naha! Violation! Like the Pharisees with their referee outfits, they came out, you know, yellow card, right? Violation. Why? Because that's harvesting food. And harvesting is work. And you cannot work on the Sabbath. You know, of course, the irony of all this is that work is not actually defined anywhere in the law or in the Old Testament. It's up to you to know and to figure out what it means for you to work, and therefore what it means for you to rest from that work, and therefore use that day as something holy and something sacred to celebrate rest. All these layers of rules, they're nowhere in the scriptures. They were just invented by the teachers. They weren't actually from the law. You know, Jesus responds by citing this example from the Old Testament that you can actually read about. When King David, he was on the run at one point, as he was a good many times in his life. He was on the run, and his companions were on the run. They were hungry. They were worn out. And they just so happened to come across the tabernacle. And in the tabernacle was set up the sacred bread, which, according specifically to the law, could only be touched and eaten or handled by the priests. But here David is, he's running for his life. He's worn out. His guys are worn out. So they come across the tabernacle, and you know what they do? They snatch themselves some bread. And they eat it. And you know what? They're not condemned for it. God doesn't condemn them. And Jesus actually points this out because he says, look, even David, who did specifically violate something, see, he was able to do that. Jesus and his companions, they weren't even violating the law. They were just violating some made-up rules of the teachers of the day. They were in need, David and his companions. So it was okay. And Jesus then has this great line, verses 27 to 28. The Sabbath was made for people, not people for the Sabbath, right? And again, this goes back to the idea of like, look, the Sabbath was made for people. You get to, what is work to you? So you rest from that. What is work for you? Take a rest from it. Have faith in God. He'll take care of you if you don't do that work that day. Take a rest from that. Celebrate. What's work for you, right? The Sabbath, not the other way around. Beware of legalism. You know, there's hallmarks of legalism that we see throughout the New Testament, and even ones that come up here, and I'll point out a couple of these. And these are important to think about even today. Some of the hallmarks of legalism: valuing procedures and rules over people and relationships. And this is why David and his companions were able to eat the bread and it was okay. Why? Because God actually valued the people more than he valued the procedure that was in place. But legalism tends to flip that around. Legalism misses the forest for the trees. It emphasizes the minutiae of religion, but misses the big picture. And this is what Jesus pointed out. It's like, look, you guys are kind of missing the point of the Sabbath. You're so uptight about observing the particulars, the minutiae of this and that, you miss the whole idea of it. Because of legalism. It's focusing on the outward act and missing the heart behind it. Or elevating the opinions and the traditions above the word of God. These are aspects and hallmarks of legalism and things that we can still fall into today. I do want to make a note, though, that obedience is not the same thing as legalism. Jesus was honoring the Sabbath. He was not disobeying the law. Because sometimes, too, we can, you know, you see a scripture about like, well, look, hey, I know this is a sin, but let's not be legalistic. No, that's not legalism. Right? That's not legalism. Striving to obey the word of God is not the same thing as being legalistic. That's just striving to love God and obey his commands, right? But legalism, if it's not seen, if it's not diagnosed, if it's not dealt with, it does breed another dangerous spiritual condition. I would say, in my study of the New Testament, the most dangerous spiritual condition. And it gets exposed in the hearts of the Pharisees by Jesus in the next section. Let's read on. Chapter 3, verses 1 to 6. Then Jesus entered the synagogue, and again a man was there who had a withered hand. They watched Jesus closely to see if he would heal him on the Sabbath, so that they could accuse him. So he said to the man who had the withered hand, "Stand up among all these people." Then he said to them, that's the people, "Is it lawful to do good on the Sabbath or evil? To save a life or destroy it?" But they were silent. And after looking around at them in anger, grieved by the hardness of their hearts, he said to the man, "Stretch out your hand." He stretched it out, and his hand was restored. So the Pharisees went out immediately and began plotting with the Herodians as to how they could assassinate him. Another situation set up on the Sabbath, and the Pharisees were hoping to ambush Jesus. According to the tradition in place, attempting to heal or help someone on the Sabbath was only permissible in a life-threatening situation. So our poor friend here with the withered hand, as bad as it was to have a withered hand, was not in a life-threatening situation. And the Pharisees would have known this. And Jesus would have known this as well. You see, it's interesting because in this instance, the Pharisees are trying to set up the ambush, but then you know what happens? Jesus ambushes them, doesn't he? Jesus takes their trap and he springs it on them. Because he's the one who initiates it, right? He tells the man with the withered hand, "Stand up in front of everyone. We're going to do this here and now." And then he's the one who asks the questions to the group. So, is it lawful to do good or evil on the Sabbath? And their silence is deafening. And so he does it. He creates the situation to show the Pharisees the error of their ways. You know, Jesus did not make the religious establishment his enemy. He's trying to help. He's trying to preach. He's trying to teach them the same that he is for everyone. But their hard-hearted opposition made them his enemies. And here we see something very interesting about Jesus. He gets mad. He is angry and he is grieved. Jesus has shown great kindness, great patience, great compassion so far throughout the book of Mark in all of his ministry, hasn't he? But here we get to a breaking point. A line gets crossed with Jesus that he finds intolerable. It's when the selfish and proud attitudes of the people who are supposed to be leaders and shepherds get in the way of actually healing and helping the needy and the vulnerable, Jesus gets mad. He's angry and he's grieved. When holy days and holy times like the Sabbath, intended to promote devotion to God, are manipulated to become traps To further selfish ambitions, Jesus gets mad. He exposes them. And what it talks about here is the real enemy, the hard heart. You know, the Pharisees, the teachers of the law, they become very easy to villainize in the Gospels. And it's easy that they just get this veneer of being the quote-unquote bad guys. But you know what? There's some Pharisee and teacher of the law inside all of us. And it's not the Pharisees. It's not being a teacher of the law. You know, there were religious leaders and the Pharisees and teachers who actually became disciples of Jesus. The enemy is always Satan. And the problem is the spiritual condition of hard-heartedness. You know, in the Bible, heart does not refer to the organ that pumps the blood. What the heart is it's the central motherboard of our emotional, our intellectual, and our spiritual selves. It's the place where we weigh priorities. It's the place where we develop attitudes. It's the place where we formulate our desires and our ambitions. And it's where we make our choices. That happens in our hearts. The heart cannot be closed off. It needs to be open. It needs to be malleable. Some hallmarks of a hard heart. It hears but does not listen to the word of God. You ever been in a situation where you're talking to someone and you get that feeling like you're hearing me but you're not listening? Right? That was Jesus' interaction with the hard-hearted. They're hearing but not listening. There's a hard heart there. A hard heart is proud. It's defensive. It's easily threatened and easily offended. Because it lacks humility. It tends to lack conscience. It loses a sense of right and wrong. It lacks compassion. And it lacks self-awareness. How blind had the Pharisees become? That these holy men, you know what they left this episode thinking? How can we kill this guy? What irony, what lack of self-awareness that they would arrive to the synagogue on the Sabbath, witness Jesus do a miracle, and leave in their hearts thinking, we have to kill this guy. And they didn't see anything wrong with themselves. The hard heart, because it's proud, it blinds us. We can't see ourselves clearly. A hard heart, it's the most dangerous and deadly spiritual condition in the New Testament because it stands in complete opposition to Jesus' call to repentance. And without repentance, there is no seeing or entering the kingdom. Pride, legalism, these things produce hard hearts. And these are the lessons from the Sabbath ambush. The Pharisees thought that they would spring a trap on Jesus and expose him, but it backfires. The Pharisees are the ones who get ambushed. They fall over their own trap, and they expose themselves. Beware legalism, beware the hard heart. And again, for us, let's let Jesus continue to call us to repentance. Do you see legalism in your life? Hard-heartedness in your life? As this discussion and as these lists came up, there was probably a thing or two that twinged on the inside with maybe one, maybe two, maybe several of these points. That's evidence of the soft heart. Follow that up. Respond to that. Let Jesus continue to call us to repentance. Let him continue to mold and change us. Because you know, particularly those who are here amongst us who've been in church for a while, have been around the Christian faith for a while, have been religious for a while, you know, the longer we're around, the harder it can get for us to change. And we need to let Jesus continue to call us to that change. It's kind of like in physical life. You know, there's experiments and studies that have been done on neuroscience that the brains of children, how malleable they are. and how flexible they are. And they go through these phases where that's why we see it in children. They go through these accelerated phases of just learning very quickly. Suddenly their words, their actions, their responses, because their brains are fresh. But it also shows that the older we get, we carve neural pathways into our brains through repeated habit, through repeated thoughts that are then reinforced by repeated habits. And the longer we carve these pathways, it shows the harder it is for our brains to adjust off of these pathways. It literally gets more difficult for us to change the older that we get. But we cannot give in to that. We need to let Jesus, through the power of his call of repentance, through the miraculous work of the Holy Spirit, continue to teach us anew. You know, for myself, being here in Scotland, so much of this has been a process of just letting Jesus reshift my paradigm. Reshift me completely. I mean, several months ago, I really started to pray. I was like, Jesus, I see it. I realize it being here. How much I need to change. How much I need to continue to grow. And it's not a matter of looking back on the past 10 years of my Christian life and my ministry experience and saying, oh, that was all a mistake. It was all garbage. No, it's not that. It's just realizing, like, man, God, you are doing so many new different things. I need to change with it to keep up with it. I need to change with it in order to help the church to grow and keep up with it. And you know what? I saw that. I started praying that. And it makes me insecure. It makes me scared. It makes me feel vulnerable. And I can feel my heart hardening at times, and I can insist, no, my way of doing ministry, my way of seeing it, the things that I know, my expectations for how it should be built are correct, or I can be soft and malleable and open and let Jesus sift my weaknesses and my character, let him lead and let his Spirit lead and teach fresh ways forward. But it's tough at times because I worry. I worry that the group here will lose faith in me if you see me struggle. And that if I don't have the, you know, sort of the right veneer of knowing all the answers and knowing what's going on and having the right plan and the right strategy with the right outcomes. But I realize that's part of what needs to get come down with me, with all of us. So that way we can let Jesus teach us new. And teach us fresh with soft hearts what it really means to continue to pursue his kingdom and build it up. And I thank the group. I thank you for your patience with me. And I thank you for your faith. But let it not be faith in me, and it's not faith in one another. It's faith in Jesus. And faith in the power of his Holy Spirit to continue to teach us, to continue to lead the way, to keep striving together in fresh ways to build his kingdom. Amen.
Amen. Amen.